Few years before Project Mac, the first programming language Fortran was introduced. One thing interesting about Fortran was it has only one data structure. The data structure was tensors. So in fact, I have the exact diagram that Joel had, so I don't want to talk about that. So this language basically, from that point of onwards, almost every programming language introduced tensors, multiple tensors in there. And today, a large part of world's data and a lot of computation is done on these dense tensors. The issue is the world is not dense. Lot of information in the world has much more structural properties. For example, sparsity. Or data is replicated. A lot of times you have runs of same value in many, many different data sets in here. Or there's a lot of symmetrical properties of data. Or there's a lot of structure embedded into our data that daily we work on there. So the issue is, how do you take advantage of that? In fact, I'm going to talk a little bit deeper into the sparse data. Sparse data is everywhere, even though our languages only deal with dense data structures. So for example, data analytics to all modern machine learning, and also for last 50 years, a lot of science and engineering data had a sparsity. To give you an example how much this is important, we look at something like Amazon data set that talks about all, that keeps the information about all its product reviews. So in this data set, this is a three tensor. So it has a dimension for every product Amazon sell, another dimension for every person who bought a product in Amazon, and also every word anybody has used to write a review in there. Now, you can represent it using a dense three tensor. If you do that, the entire Amazon data center won't have enough storage to do that. But if you realize, I don't buy every Amazon product, everybody doesn't write huge reviews, so in fact, the data is extremely sparse, and if you only record the non-zero values, it will fit in your laptop. So this is very, very important to get sparsity out of this data. So let me tell you about the little bit of difficulty of a sparsity in there. So if you have a two tensor like that, a matrix, normally in memory, you keep it in contiguous memory. It's very simple. This is what Fortran till now most languages do. And they are finding where the value is very easy. So you have calculated that. I know where that value is if you give the index in here. But the problem is I have all these zeros I'm storing. So what I want to do is, instead of doing that, how do I compress this thing? Don't store the zeros. But now, how do you figure out what that value is? Because we don't know. So we need to keep additional data called metadata. And the metadata will say, for that value, what the row and column number is. This is called the coordinate format. And people realize this is even more, can be compressed more because there are some duplicate values. And so today, the commonly used format is called compressed sparse row format that basically only stores all the non-zero values in a very compressed way in here. This is very commonly used today. The interesting thing in here is how difficult it to compute in that. So here we have a computation that is doing a three tensor multiplied by a one tensor vector. If everything is dense, a freshman can write this piece of code. The problem is, as some things get sparse, if the first three tensor is sparse, the code gets a little bit more complicated. If both are sparse, you need to write even more complicated code. Now, if you do a small change by adding two three tensors, this is the code you need to write, a long-term employment for a lot of programmers, but this is not a good way of keep programming in here. So this is hard. Even though it's hard, you can get a lot of benefits in here. So here what I'm showing here is performance of sparse matrix multiply given the sparsity, as if when it is dense, close to dense, using the sparse structures and the complicated code has some overhead. This is before all the architecture that Joel was talking about. This is just running on a normal x86 processor that's tuned for dense, basically. But at some point, you get it better and better performance. And if there's a lot of sparsity, you have a huge amount of performance. Why? Because if you multiply by zero, you don't have to do anything. You don't even have to fetch an item. So normally, you keep zeros, multiply. You don't have to do anything in here. If you add, you just have to fetch the data and copy. I don't have to do the operation. So because of these two, I can do a lot less operation, lot less data fetches, and you get good performance. Matrix-matrix multiply, the cutoff point is a little bit lower. But again, if you look at where the data is, large amount of data, things like sparse neural networks, is right now at the cusp of getting performance using matrix-matrix multiply, and that's the main operation here. But there are many different other domains where sparsity is in much large numbers. So you can get huge amount of performance in here. But the problem is, writing this code is extremely hard. Managing these data structures are hard. There are a lot of different data structures. So what we have done is build a compiler that you can just give the computation expression using Einsam notation that Joel introduced earlier. You can tell any format these data can be in and give some additional things to optimize the program, and we can generate both C code and CUDA code, and also we are working on to generate code for accelerators. So by doing that, we can make all this sparse code and all this sparse data and all the structured data the same level of programming for dense code and get all the performance benefits here. Let me show you one piece of code in here. So here's some data that has structure. So if you look at this MRI image and this alpha bending of two different videos, the dense, the size doesn't change. That's you have to represent everything. If you just eliminate zeros, you get some benefit in here. But in both of these codes, there are a lot of repeated values. The first one, they are both zeros and ones repeated a lot. So if you do this run length encoding compression, you get a huge compression in both of these things. In the first, almost 30x compression in here, and the second one, about 15x compression in here. So the compression community knew that. They compress data for transmission and storage. But when they had to perform computation, they will expand it back into dense arrays, dense tensors, and do the computation and recompress again. But now, because we can directly work on dense data, we can actually do the work on already on compressed data. So if you work on compressed data, I don't have to expand anything. I don't have to do all this additional computation. So by doing that, we can get a lot of performance just doing that. And what we have done is made it possible for programmers to write the code as they are working on dense data. But actually, in fact, the data is compressed. So we are going to operate on compressed data and get great performance. Thank you very much.